Welcome! Today we talk about RESTHeart, a backend for web and mobile applications, which allows to fast create REST APIs. As the official website says, RESTHeart is a modern backend for web and mobile applications which simplifies the server-side development by addressing three issues: data persistence, authentication and authorization, and API. These three issues are addressed by using MongoDB for data persistence, an access and security managing system, and by using JSON as data interchange format, which is the REST API's standard. We can easily create backend for mobile applications by using the classic frameworks such as Angular, React, Vue, as well as mobile applications for Android and iOS. The easiest way to use it is by downloading and unpacking a zip or tar compressed file. There is no need to install anything because we have a pre-compiled jar package. There are also other alternatives, such as the execution with a Docker image or even by compiling the source code. Let's start by using the binaries that we can find in the file that we downloaded. Once the compressed archive has been unpacked, it is possible to see the structure of the directories. The main file is restart.jar. Then there are two other directories. One of them is related to the plugins, and it contains the parts interacting with MongoDB, as well as another jar file which manages security. The etc directory contains the configuration files. As we will see in more detail, restart.yaml is the configuration file which uses the mustache notation so that it can enhance the various properties through the .properties files. This allows us to have different configurations where we can change the properties. For example, we can change the port bound to the restart instance, the MongoDB instance to be used, and many other parameters that we will see in more detail. For what concerns authentication, inside the users.yaml file, there is the list of all the users enabled to use RESTHeart, with the relative passwords and rows. The rows are defined in the acl.yaml file. We have the admin role, which can do all possible operations, and a user role, with limited authorizations. Talking about the practical aspects, since the code is written in Java, we need to run Java 11. We also need to run MongoDB 3 or 4 on the 27.0.17 port. In my case, I have a Docker container which I start by using portainer. Then I select and start MongoDB. The door is the default one, that is the 27.0.17. Now we can initiate RESTHeart. We are now inside the RESTHeart folder, where we unzipped the zip file. Here we see the command to be used to start the instance: java-jar, restart.jar, etc/restart.yaml, -e, etc/default.properties. This is a command to execute a classic jar file. RESTHeart is the main file, particularly restart.yaml is the main configuration file parameterized with the mustache notation. The properties that enhance the configuration file can be found inside default.properties. This allows to have different configurations so that we can have more than one .properties files with different settings. For example, we can change the port restart is bound to, the connection to the MongoDB database, and so on. So, let's run it. As we can see, it is starting. And now, RESTHeart is running. As we can see, the default port is the 8080. Now we can go on. We are ready to continue with the configuration operations. So we move on to the tutorial that we find on RESTHeart's official website. The documentation is very detailed and well presented. As we will see, there is also the chance to execute the different commands directly on the REST Ninja tool, without having to use external tools such as Postman, curl, command line tools, and so on. The first thing we need to do is to create the RESTHeart database through the put request to the endpoint slash. So, this will allow us to create a RESTHeart database. For those who never used the REST Ninja, let's see a brief overview. We can select the request verb, such as get, post, put, and so on. In this case, we have put. Here we specify the resource to invoke. In our case, it's going to be HTTP localhost 8080 slash. So here we have the chance to set the request body for the specific headers if required. We can also set the format, which in our case is JSON, but it can also be XML or text. Since the request must be authenticated, we already set a basic authentication directly with the following credentials: name admin and password secret. This authentication sends us back to the users.yaml file, where we can find the credentials of all the users allowed to use RESTHeart. Now we can execute the command. The response status is 200, which means that everything is OK. In short, this means that we created the RESTHeart database. Let's go back to the tutorial and let's continue with the next operation. The next task is the creation of a test collection called inventory. In this case, we still have to execute a put request, but this time on the slash inventory endpoint. We use REST Ninja again. We can see that, once again, REST Ninja sets all the necessary configurations to make a request. Here the resource changed. It became HTTP localhost 8080 slash inventory. If we go in auth, we still find the authentication informations. Let's execute the request. Also in this case we have 200. I did not mention this before, but here you can also see the response headers, as well as the authentication token and its validity, the content type, and the entity tag associated to the request. This is a hash request, and it's very useful when there is the need to do caching or some conditional requests, and therefore conditional checks. So, if we want to do the caching of the request, we can use this tag to verify if there was any alteration and, in case, to update the cache or to return the content of the cache in order to speed up the operations needed to access the data. Let's go back to the tutorial. Now that we have our collection, we can populate it. In this case, we do not have a put anymore, but a post in slash inventory. Moreover, in the body, we must specify a JSON object. We have a series of values which are specified, such as item, quantity, size, status, and so on. This operation too can be easily managed through REST Ninja. In fact, we can see that everything is ready. This is a post where we have the resource, the authentication settings, and the body. Now we select send, and there it is. We obtain the response from the operation, and we see that 5 elements were inserted inside the database. This is a preview, and we can see the data in raw format and the headers. Now we can query the database to see the data we just entered. In this case, we can modify the request directly, since it is a get on slash inventory, as we can see from the tutorial, without having to send anything from the body. We can create a get. Obviously, we do not have the body anymore. Now we should have as a result a JSON object, containing all the items we previously inserted. And here is the answer. According to the data we inserted, there are also additional fields, that is the object identifier underscore ID, as well as the e-tag, that is the entity tag that we inserted. Here it is. To conclude this first tutorial, let's see a couple of other options. For example, the possibility to use some filters on the documents found inside a collection which must be specified in the resources URL. In this case, for example, we can filter out all the documents in which the quantity is greater than 75. So we still have a get on slash inventory, but then we apply the parameters with the filter, which is equal to the condition in JSON format. This is the way MongoDB operates. Some knowledge about MongoDB and about how to query MongoDB databases and filter the data is assumed. The first part we can see here is equivalent to the get we previously did and which returns everything. After the question mark, there is filter equal quantity. $GT means greater than the value, which in this case is 75. If we execute that, we can see that 2 out of the 5 documents we inserted have been returned, which are those whose quantity is greater than 75. If, for example, we set a quantity greater than 1775, nothing should be returned, since we had no elements with that quantity. In fact, we get an empty array. That is all for the moment, and see you soon!